Section 7.4, Pi Trust. Well, Pi Trust is an entry in a table called the Pi Trust table that's going to associate a specific application or host name or a Windows domain that is trying to connect, or I should say it's going to associate an incoming connection that has a specific either application name or host name or comes from a specific Windows domain or a specific Windows user, it's going to associate that incoming client with a specific Pi user. So what it does is it allows us to, well, leverage the single sign-on using Windows username. So for example, the Windows user that belongs to a certain domain, we can say if you're a member of that domain and have that username, we're going to give you the same privileges as a specific Pi user. Let me explain further. When we have an interface that's installed on a data acquisition node, it's going to need read-write access to the Pi server. But this is an application that's going to run 24 hours a day, over the weekend, etc. So you don't want to get this phone call at 4 in the morning on a Saturday night saying, the operator saying, hey, can you give me the password for this data collection node? You know, this data acquisition node is asking me for a password. You don't want that. No, you simply want this to be able to connect through something called a trust table to the Pi database using a specific Pi user that you've predefined. So you would do that by creating a trust entry in this thing that we call the trust table. Now, the trust table needs to have some basis for trusting a connection. So if this data access or acquisition node is coming in, we need to derive what we call connection credentials from that node. Now, we can derive a variety of them, but two of the ones that we can derive are these two right here, the IP address and the host name. So at its simplest, we can simply derive those two things from the incoming connection, and then if they match something in the trust table, then we can associate that incoming client with a specified Pi user. And then once we have that user, we can grant him privileges to the databases as he would if he were that Pi user. So the interface is basically going to be granted the same privileges as that user. You know what it's like? It's like, well, if you've ever seen, you know, the Hollywood, it's kind of a cliche of a bunch of people standing backstage trying to get in. And there's a big bouncer who says, you're not going to get in unless you're on the list. That's what the Pi Trust table looks like. Imagine this as a list that says you're not allowed in unless you're on that list. Now, you can either identify yourself by your address or your host name, and there's three other credentials, your domain, your Windows user, and others. So we have connection credentials that we can use to validate whether you are on that list or not, whether you are in this trust table. And once we find you on that list, we gave you the privileges of the Pi user that you were associated with on the list. And we even have it set up so that if you, for example, match two items on the list, let's say, you know, you match two connection credentials, then we have a kind of a scoring system to see which user you get connected as or which trust takes precedence. Now, here's how it works. And if you don't mind, just wait a second. I'm going to show you what a trust looks like as it's actually configured in the table. So trust me, we're going to get to that soon enough. But let's imagine we've got this incoming connection. It might be a copy of the OPC interface, for example. We are going to derive specific connection credentials from that incoming connection. Now, I'm very careful to say that we're going to derive connection credentials, because in fact, it's not the client, it's not the interface that sends the credentials. It's actually the server that needs to derive those credentials using, in some cases, reverse name lookup or other networking utilities. But in any case, we derive a set of connection credentials. And those credentials might be a handful of three things, or it could be up to five things. We have for certain of our connecting clients, we can get up to five connection credentials. We take a look within the Pi trust table to see if there's a trust definition that matches the incoming connection credentials. If there is a match, then we assign a Pi user to that incoming connection. And the incoming connection, the application associated with that, gets all the privileges of that Pi user. If we don't match, then we simply, well, we go to the next step. If it's an incoming client like process book or data link, the user will see a connection dialog box. He'll be prompted for a username and password. So typically we set up these trusts so that we have trust definitions so that interfaces can connect without having a user password prompt. So let's actually look at one. I'm going to go over into the trust table. If you look under security, under trusts, you'll see a list of trusts. And let's just take a look at this one right here. I'll double click on this. This is a trust whose trust name, of course, is completely arbitrary. I could have called it Fred if I wanted to, but it's called MyTrust1. In this case, I'm specifying the connection credentials are that the network path, that's going to be either the local node name or the fully qualified domain name. So that might be something like this, joepc.osisoft.com. You could specify it either way. Typically, it's different for different types of connections, and we'll explain more about that later on. But that's going to be one of the connection criteria. Okay, is this trust specifies that we're looking for connections from the computer called Joe PC. We're also looking for an application name called APIBE. That stands for API Buffering. And we'll talk more about what that E stands for later on. Now, what this is saying is, if we get an incoming connection credential that matches those two criteria, it comes from this computer and it's using this application, it's coming from that application on that computer, then we say, great, we've got a match, you know, you're on the list, and we're going to give you the same credentials as this Pi user. Here's my list of Pi users. I'm going to give him the credentials as the Pi user. Now, that's just one trust. As you can see, you can do other trusts. So here's a trust in which the connection credentials are this IP address and this netmask. We'll talk more about that a little bit later on. We're also specifying the Windows domain name. And what we're specifying here is that if you're in the OSI domain and you're coming from any of the IP addresses from 0 to 255 in this, I think that's a Class C subnet, then we're going to associate your Windows account with the user called PyAdmin. And here's yet another that simply looks for anybody in the OSI domain and associates that Windows user with the Pi user of the same name. And we'll explain what these abbreviations mean later on. So as you may have noticed, the Pi Trust Database, it is a table of trust records. Each record includes a unique name for the trust. So I already showed you MyTrust1, MyTrust2, etc. They're unique and arbitrary. A Pi username, that's kind of the grand finale of the trust. If we match an incoming connection, then that incoming connection gets the same privileges as that Pi username. And then we have to specify some connection credentials. And we need to specify up to five of these. The application name, the domain name, the IP address, the host, which would be basically either the local computer name or the fully qualified domain name, along with, for example, joepc.osisoft.com as opposed to just joepc. And then finally, the username from the operating system. In other words, that would be the Windows username. So we derive any one of those five connection credentials. So a trust is going to have one of those. And the more that it has, the more specific the criteria for this trust to match, the more difficult and secure a trust it is. So for example, using the bouncer analogy, if somebody said, hey, let anybody in with a tux, then, well, that's restrictive. But if you say, let anybody in with a tux who's driving a Maserati, well, that's a lot more restrictive. So the more connection criteria you specify, the more restrictive the trust is going to be. Just like if we specify both an application name and an IP address, that's going to be more restrictive than just specifying the application name by itself.